call a meeting to order of the July 21st Blue Earth Board of Commissioners meeting. First, we'll say our Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And we'll go to our agenda review, Bob.
Mr. Chair, there are no changes to the agenda today.
I move the agenda.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Against? Passed. Commissioners' reports on committees. Let's start with Kip.
You just can't wait to hear about the pen, can you?
I have a pen that's just amazing.
Well, you're going to have to wait till the end of my report.
Okay.
That's the end of my report.
10 minutes from now? Or?
Yep. Actually, it's a relatively quiet last couple weeks. After our last board meeting, we had a Highway 14 improvements in Eagle Lake. They're doing some improvements to the highway out there with the intersections. So they had an open house in Eagle Lake. Had a good turnout. There's probably 50, 60 people there. And a lot of good questions, comments, talking about the intersections. We're closing some of them down to three-quarter intersections with R-turns, so the R-turns created a lot of buzz, but had a video going, and just learning how R-turns work as I'm going through this process was informative to me, so I encourage people to come up there and understand those R-turns. But the people that I was talking to after they started hearing about this were thinking the R-turns were, I have to get out and I have to try to get between the two lanes of traffic, so you come out when there's somebody in the other lane and you get out. Well, they explained to MnDOT that the R-turn is made for you wait a gap in both lanes, and then you dart right across over to the R-turn. So it's not trying to weave over. It's get the gap, and then you turn around and get the gap going the other way. So I don't think the R-turn is going to get used a whole lot, but there was some good questions about it. A little bit of concern about how the trucks are going to turn around on it, but the MnDOT staff was there, and they did a great job answering questions and went really well.
It's like $1 point something million worth of improvements.
Right? Yeah, just short of $2 million. Yeah. All three intersections are going to get improved. They talked about leaving the County Road 56 one as it is, but they thought because of the improvements they're going to do on County Road 17 and making that a three-quarter intersection, it might push some more traffic down to 56.
Oh, yeah.
So they thought they're going to do a three-quarter intersection there too. So,
wow.
That's the intersection that my business is on, and it's going to be non-eventful for me. There's a big apartment complex going up right on that corner. That person is aware that that is going to be a three-quarter intersection. He's not concerned about it. They had a lot of traffic counts for which way traffic was going out of all three of those intersections, and the traffic going to the left out of that intersection towards Mankato was very minimal, a lot lower than I thought. So I think it'll be non-eventful.
But it's going to be more lighting around too.
I would imagine more lighting. Yeah. So the biggest one is the 17 one, and then the one at Casey's on 55. Or am I getting these fixed mixed up? But the one at Casey's is going to have an enhanced right turn lane, so you know the people are turning right, and then it's going to have a third lane for an acceleration lane. Should work out pretty well. Projects are slated for next year. Then I was at the Moondogs game with the MRCI employees. They had a good turnout, probably about 350 employees and their families, and had a little picnic before, and got to go and let them know how much we appreciate all their hard work. Was on a conference call with Amanda and Lynn from MVAC. We have had an audit that they are doing because of all the stuff with the nonprofits up in the cities. They're doing audits, a special audit on all these nonprofits. I think ours went really well. We answered all their questions. Took about 45 minutes. We were figuring a couple hours. So that went really well. We're supposed to be getting a report on that by the end of September, from what I understand. Then we had an informational meeting on JD 34, county ditch over by Eagle Lake area. Had about a dozen people there. It's not a real big system, but we are starting the initiation. But again, a big ticket item, $1.5 million. And yeah. You know, you only got a handful of landowners. This is about $75 an acre.
Oh,
for 15 years, if they do the 15 years, so it's a big undertaking. But you know, they're supportive of it because they need the drainage and the ditch. It's 100 years old. It was built in 1919. They figured somewhere in that area, so it's just wore out. Need the drainage. So
is Eagle Lake on that portion of the ditch? I mean, is Eagle Lake part of it too, or not?
No, no, not the city, no. Nope, this is all out in the rural area, kind of northeast area, so. But it, so we got consensus that people want to move forward with it, so somebody's going to start a petition. And we had tater days last weekend. I got to judge the cook-off they had, so we got to taste some barbecued ribs and some barbecued chicken. Had a great turnout. Didn't get up to the parade in time because I had to run out of town for a little bit, but I got back for the end of the parade. Had a great turnout up there in the afternoon and in the evening, and sounded like everything went really well with that.
Nice.
And then last night we had our MVAC annual meeting, and we always give out awards to achievers and supporters. And just an FYI, Blue Earth County, our very own Eric Olson, with the Sentence to Serve crew, got the supporter award from Blue Earth County staff.
Wow.
Up there. So
nice.
Apparently they are very helpful with doing different projects and helped us get moved into the new building up there. And
kudos and, to them.
Yeah, so got to visit with Eric for a few minutes after the program, and as you know, he does a great job around here with all the stuff. And very informative. And there comes the pens. That's where you got the pens.
You want us to wave them?
It was appropriate. Ann thought that since they, you know, they were blue and we had some little blue hair, that all the county boards should get one. So they were handing those out and some other items. So but they had a great program.
Does that signify our age then? The
it
blue
could,
hair then?
Yeah.
No, I'm wondering.
Yeah, apparently you can clean stuff with the little hair, and then it's got a thing for punching on your iPad.
I've never seen one like that before. That's nice.
Yeah. So that's where that came from.
Thank you.
Yeah, but it was a good program. There was about 130 people there, and was up at the college. They always do a great job up there, and had a good time.
Nice, thank
you.
That's
my report, Mr. Chair.
All right, Mark.
Okay, these last couple of weeks have, you three are doing a lot of work there out with the NACO. Actually, some of the committees I had don't meet in July, or this July they haven't. But I did, as alternate, go to the Gerberba, July 16th, Gerberba. It was at Fish Lake, the farm. It was like more like a conservation farm tour at the Willow Lake Farm out there in near Windham. And it was quite informative. They got a little bit into the buffer legislation. And, of course, you know, they passed that without really having it all figured out with the how they can define everything, but that'll be interesting how that works out. They did have those island rafts that they got at Lake Crystal in the near Lake Crystal there in the Crystal Lake to help with the wildlife habitat, and they had, we could see them up front and or up close, I should say, and they're they're interesting. They, you know, they don't really know how much they know they help, but they don't really know how, you know, how real effective they'll be, but they certainly would help. So that was interesting. So yeah, it was a good day, and I noticed since I haven't been on the Gerberba for a while that it's more active. It's got a little bit more funding, a lot more grants. Yeah,
get a lot of grant dollars they apply for.
Doing a lot of good projects. So then Blue Earth County Historical Society did have their 50th anniversary with the Vikings training camp, and I got to part of that, and that was interesting, and kind of it was a fundraiser for them, but it was then they had all the press that showed up, or press came, or and they publicized it quite a bit, and so if you are interested in Vikings memorabilia and so forth, you ought to see the tour, the exhibits that are at the Historical Society right now for, I think when they're done, camp's done in May, in August, mid-August or whatever. Maybe it's September 1st, I think, yeah. Anyway, that concludes my program, Mr. Chair.
All right, Drew. Okay, let's see here, here it is. Our last meeting was July 7th, and Wednesday, July 8th, I attended the Region 9 full commission meeting. We had our outgoing chair, Jim Swanson, who's been serving for several years on the Region 9 board. He's a Sibley County Commissioner. And then new chair is our own Brad Ehrenstorf. You know who that is. Mm-hmm. Mayor out there, Lake Crystal.
Crystal, yeah.
Yeah. And so he'll be serving as the new chair for Region 9. Mm-hmm. We had several new appointments to the full commission, including another one that you'll recognize, Lyle Femright.
Mm.
Oh, yeah. You know, so from townships.
Been very involved in townships and county committees and things like that. So, and then on Thursday, the next day on the 9th, flew out to Charlotte, North Carolina to attend the NACO annual conference. Started the next morning on July 10th, Friday. And the first report, I'll just kind of touch on, because they had workshops and steering committees and things all throughout. It was a four-day conference, and like you here, we had hot, humid weather there. It was 98 degrees and 80% humidity. Luckily, most of it was indoors. I attended a lot of the health, behavioral health, and things related to health type trainings that they had and steering committees. I just want to mention one that I attended for sure that was on that Friday, and it was Health Behavioral Health Subcommittee and the Justice Public Safety Courts and Corrections Subcommittee. And we had Mark Refowitz from Orange County. There were several people who presented throughout the conference from Orange County. Orange County is one of the largest counties in the country. It's right there, right alongside LA. And they spoke real specifically to how important county behavioral health providers are in our communities in treating and guiding treatment for those with mental illness, also with those with substance abuse, and sometimes combined. The relationship between our justice system and access to services is huge. And in many counties, they spend about a third of their budget, basically, on those issues. And so it was really good to hear what they're doing in other counties around the country. They're doing a different forms of triage when people are getting in a little bit of trouble in the community. They have different ways of funneling people. Instead of going into jail, they're trying to funnel them into getting appropriate treatment. If they have to go to jail, they still are hooking them up with services. And that even includes if they don't have a Medicaid account, they're getting them to sign up for Medicaid before they're actually found guilty or not guilty. And this has really been helping alleviate some of the mental illness in the jails there in these counties. And the impact financially to their budgets is huge. It's a huge savings. I attended actually three workshops related to behavioral health, mental health, substance abuse, and our justice system. And it was very interesting to hear the work that's being done, the actual examples that they're doing around the country. And I've even had some discussions a little bit with Pat. Pat's been talking a little bit about that, our county attorney, about dealing with some of these issues. And so I look forward to having more discussions about this. And I've got so much in my notes that I'm just starting to process all the information. And so I got some wonderful handouts I plan to share with some of you too regarding some of these workshops that I attended. I do want to mention that I was happy that I met a man. His name is Jerry Abramson. I don't know if you know who that is. But he's a man who is from the Louisville, Kentucky area. And he was a mayor for many years there. And believe it or not, Louisville, Kentucky and the county in 2003 formed a joint governmental system so that it works in conjunction with each other. And so Jerry Abramson also ran for that as a mayor. And he is the new, for the last year now, he stepped down from working down there in Kentucky. And he is the new, what would you call it, intergovernmental affairs director to the president. And he spoke to us also at the convention. And what a dynamic guy. Very, very dynamic. I was really impressed with him. Anyway, and then I'll move on. That conference got over on the 13th, flew home on the 14th. Wednesday the 15th, right away I attended the Highway 14 partnership over in Owatonna. And we had a lot of business to cover, some updates. I just want to mention one of the parts of the Highway 14 partnership meeting. We had a panel of eight of our state legislators. And Senator Kathy Sharon, Vicki Jensen, Representative Kim Norton, John Petersburg, Clark Johnson, Paul Torkelson, Brian Daniels, Jack Considine. They were all there to give us feedback on how things have been going in transportation and how things are, in their perspective, how to deal with things going forward in the future with our transportation funding that we need. And then Friday, I attended the planning committee for AMC for our annual conference, and we met at that downtown Hilton in Minneapolis, and we spent about 4 or 5 hours together there and covered a lot of ground for this year's conference. We're going to have a really wonderful conference set up with the help of the AMC staff. And then Friday, I also attended that Vikings display of 50 years of having the Vikings training camp here in Mankato, and really enjoyed that, the Rural County Historical Society. That's my report.
Thank you. Well,
yeah.
On Friday, July 10th, I attended my subcommittee meetings for the Justice and Public Safety Steering Committee. The first meeting of the day was a joint meeting with the Health and Behavioral Health Subcommittee, and Drew gave a good report on that. I won't go over that again. Homeland Security and Emergency Management Subcommittee was next. We had a policy advisor from the Federal Insurance and Mitigation Administration. We had a FEMA representative, and they talked about working together after major events. Good information there. Again, like Drew, I brought all this handouts and stuff back, and I'll share with everybody at a later date. Then we had a Homeland Security subcommittee meeting, and we had a good speaker there from Homeland Security, and talked about the enforcement and removal operations for ICE, and how they've changed the way that they've done business. Very, very interesting there. Then we had a juvenile justice subcommittee meeting, and we had a representative talking about youth justice. There's a big, probably one of the biggest pushes that I see in youth justice right now, and this came forward in one of the platform resolutions that our committee brought forth, is to do away with the life sentence without the chance of parole for juvenile offenders who are certified as an adult for prosecution. And I think that's probably a very good thing, and I think you're going to see that moving through the national and state levels as we get down the road. And then the last subcommittee meeting of the day was the Joint Health and Human Services Education, Children and Family Subcommittee, along with the Justice and Public Steering Committee. Again, a lot of good issues there, too, numerous to mention. Then on Saturday, we had the full committee meeting of the Justice and Public Safety Steering Committee. We brought forth 10 resolutions to the NACO platform. The one I've already spoken about is doing away with the life sentences without the chance of parole for juvenile offenders. The other one, one of the others that we've been working on for many years, is asking the federal government to suspend benefits for Medicaid recipients when they go to jail, rather than canceling them.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is an issue that has just cost counties all over the United States just a bundle of money. And our committee has been working on this for years. I think we've finally gotten the attention of the national legislators, and I hope that we'll get some movement on that. Then after the committee meeting, both Vance and I attended a infrastructure financing roundtable discussion, and we divided up into groups, and I sat with some folks from the ones that stick out in my mind the most were the folks from Louisiana, and of course
we're all talking about the same issue, no matter where you're from, is how to finance these big projects. And, you know, state and federal funding is dwindling for these big projects. And one of the guys from Louisiana says, well, you think you got problems? He says, you ought to have the Mississippi River run right through the middle of your county. I said, well, what's so bad about that? He says, it costs $1 billion to build a bridge over the Mississippi River. I said, I don't care where it's at, it costs $1 billion. So wow. That was really an eye-opening experience. If you think you got it bad, there's always somebody that's... So we had some good discussion, walked away from that with a good feeling about how things are going here in Blue Earth County. We're actually pretty lucky compared to some of the folks around the country. And we had the opening session later that day. Of course, that's always very interesting. And Sunday, we had the Minnesota caucus, and there were four people running for second vice president, and this is probably one of the most important caucuses that we ever attended, because they were all just excellent candidates. The margins for support were very close, and Minnesota voted to support the candidate that actually won the election. And our final vote, there was a difference of one vote between wow. him and the second candidate. So very, very interesting. County government at its best there. after that, I attended the workshop on body cameras. It's an issue that's on everybody's mind nationwide. We had a presentation from a sheriff who has been using body cameras for quite some time, says they've been very helpful. He said that he spoke of one incident where a young black man was shot by one of their deputy sheriffs, and the family asked to view the footage from the camera, and after viewing it, they realized that their family member had actually reached for a gun and pointed it at the deputy sheriff before he was killed. So he said they didn't have the riots that there were in a lot of places, and he was a real proponent of the body cameras. and we had the, on Monday we had the business meeting and election, and again the Roy Baker was the from Tarrant County, Texas, was the winner of the election. I think he will be a very competent leader. And again, that Minnesota supported him in his efforts for becoming second vice chair. Then we attended the Central Region Caucus, the closing session, and on Monday, and on Friday I had a meeting with the executive director of TDS to talk about some issues. Yesterday I had a meeting with several of the region library directors to talk about the same issues, and we had the detox annual meeting in Brown County yesterday, and I was elected vice chair again for another year of that organization. Numbers have been up significantly this summer. It's good for detox, bad for counties. But so they come in a very strong financial position. There'll be no raise in per diems or charges to counties in this next year. So, and last night I was at the Garden City Township meeting, and I had, along with Gene Lundquist from Environmental Services, talked about some of their concerns to see if we can help them with that. And I brought back 36 gopher feet for a bounty for them. So,
well,
that completes my report.
That's the biggest thing.
Thank Did you buy them by two then? Or?
No, yes, it's 36 pairs.
36 pairs.
Pairs. All right.
It's actually 72 feet.
We're going to bypass mine until we get a little bit further in our discussion here, because we're past our 9:20. So let's start doing our drainage. Craig?
Morning, Craig. Casey.
Morning, guys.
Morning.
At today's meeting of the Blue Earth County Drainage Authority, we are requesting, in order to set a date for the final hearing, or the final improvement hearing and the redetermination of benefits of CD 28. We'd like to request this hearing to happen at 9:30 a.m. during the September 8th, 2015, Blue Earth County Board of Commissioners meeting.
I'll move approval.
Second. Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Against? It's been passed.
Very good. Also today, we are requesting an order to set a public hearing on the petition for removal of property from Blue Earth County Ditch 28 and Judicial Ditch 15. This was a previously tabled hearing. I'm recommending this hearing occur at 10:15 a.m. immediately following the CD 28 final improvement and redetermination of benefits hearing during the September 8th, 2015 Blue Earth County Board of Commissioners meeting.
Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Against? That's been passed.
Our next item is the bid award on County Ditch 34, which you should have all the information in your packets regarding that.
Okay. Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Against? That's been passed.
And finally, we have just one inspection report on JD 20, which you should also have the opportunity to review in your packet.
Move approval for repairs.
Second.
Yeah, looks like, definitely looks like there's an issue there.
Yeah.
All right, got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Against? That's been passed. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You know, that that went much faster than I was figuring.
Yeah. I will say that the costs on these ditch repairs, though, I think are going up every year. The longer it goes,
it's getting, just like everything else,
yeah,
the cost goes up.
Just goes up.
Another prime example: $1.6 million project.
Big.
Well, I will try to go through my report on committees. Again, after our meeting, we drove to Charlotte, and Friday morning I started my subcommittees for the Transportation Steering Committee. My first subcommittee was a highway subcommittee, and we had a speaker for the on the Coalition Against Bigger Trucks. And there's big issues about the 85-foot doubles, or the twin 33s that they call them. The amount of weight, the amount of how much more unsafe they are if they do have an accident. There's a lot of issues there, and people are concerned about the big trucks. And obviously, if they're going up and down the interstates, they're going to go into our counties. And so there's some issues there, and how that's going to affect the states and the counties with these going up and down the road. Next one I had was a transit rail subcommittee, and we talked about rail safety issues, discussed ways counties can work with railroads to make our communities safe and secure. The last subcommittee I was at was the airport subcommittee. And we had a really good presentation that talked about the airport and economic development that airports have for different areas. I've seen that through being on the airport commission over the last 9 years, and I really see that how much airports really affect the community. On Saturday, we had our full Transportation Steering Committee. We have a talk about MAP 21, the reauthorization and the Highway Trust Fund that's extended through July 31st. And it is, you know, just like the state is throwing band-aids and kicking the can down the road, so is the federal government on transportation. We had a very good presentation from our own Jessica Beyer, reference the advocating of transportation issues through social media. We had a National Association of County Engineers report, which talked about streamlining, safety, and funding. Later on that day, I had that roundtable, that infrastructure financing that Will spoke about. And then we had our opening session that day. We had Ashton Carter, who is the Secretary of Defense, that spoke. Jerry Abramson, which you spoke about before, that was the Deputy Assistant to the President. And then we had a Brad Daugherty, who is a TV analyst and a former basketball star, that spoke with us. On Sunday, as it was talked about, we had our Minnesota caucus. I went to the meeting on the pros and cons of body cameras with Will. That was a very interesting meeting. Later on, I took a transportation tour of Charlotte's light rail and the positive influences of growth from the light rail. On Monday, I attended a mental illness and substance abuse disorders in the justice system. I attended that with you. Whereas some of the statistics was that 25% of American adults suffer from mental illness, which really blew me away. Yeah. Some form of mental illness. Yeah. And 1/7 of U.S. adults have serious mental illness. The factors are alcohol abuse, drug abuse, trauma and abuse, and those create some seriousness in the issues. Of course, we had our elections that day, and then we had our Central Region Caucus that day. My wife and I actually camped on the way back, so we didn't get back until a couple days ago. I did find out yesterday, notified yesterday, that I was placed as chair of the airport subcommittee for transportation. Mm. So I'll have a little bit more to do with NACO.
Well.
My tie I have on today, I have to state, I have a Mickey Mouse tie on, and that was the same tie I wore 17 years ago when I got married. My wife and I got married at Sibley Park, and our wedding anniversary is this coming Friday.
Right. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Yes. That's the end of my report, and we will go into planning and zoning. And we won't make it a Mickey Mouse affair.
Let's leave all that to the chair.
Yeah,
I'll leave that to the chair. He's got a Mickey Mouse.
Morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
Good morning.
Before we begin, I'll introduce our new land use planner, Aaron Stubbs. He's been with us for about a month now, and so he is fully with us, doing well.
He got to meet all of us this morning. Aren't
yeah,
he?
Yes, right. He got to meet us.
Whether he wanted to or not. Yeah.
Now we get to meet you.
Right. And you met Ben Afai at our last meeting.
You bet.
He is one of our interns. Yeah, doing a good job.
Great. Go ahead.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. PC 12-15 is a request from Miles and Machine Bromley Revocable Trust for approval of the preliminary plat of Bromley First Edition, a subdivision plat consisting of one lot and one outlot. The property is located in the northeast quarter of the northeast quarter of Section 3, Decoria Township, and is zoned agricultural and is in the urban fringe overlay districts of the city of Mankato. Mr. Afa presented a staff report. The applicants were present and had no comment. There was no public comment and little discussion by the Planning Commission. Following the discussion, the Planning Commission voted unanimously to forward a recommendation of approval of request to the County Board. And the Board action is the resolution. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Was the, we have
Public hearing.
Public hearing. We'll open this for a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to PC 1215, please come up to the podium and state your name and address. Anyone wishing to speak to PC 1215, please come up to the podium and state your name and address. Last time, anyone wishing to speak to PC 1215, please come up to the podium and state your name and address. All right. What are the wishes of the board?
Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Just a couple questions. So they're planning on just subdividing that area right there and then building another livable building or home?
Actually, Commissioner, the house was already built on this parcel last year or the year before. And so the proposal is just to split off the house from the remaining farmland, and the farmland will be an outlot and not buildable.
Okay.
Right. So there is no additional development with this proposal. Oh,
okay.
Right.
Interesting. Okay.
Thank you. Good question. All right. Any more?
Nope.
With no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Against? It's passed. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. PC 13-15 is a request from Mitchell Abbas. It is a request for review and approval of the preliminary plat of Mitch Abbas subdivision. The proposal will include 3 lots and 4 outlots. The proposal includes areas that are zoned conservation and agricultural and areas that are within the shoreline overlay district of the Little Cottonwood River. The general area includes part of the southwest quarter of Section 16 Cambria Township and parts of the southeast and southwest quarters of Section 17 Cambria Township. Mr. Leary presented the staff report. The applicant was present and had no comment. There was no public comment and little discussion by the Planning Commission. Following the discussion, the Planning Commission voted unanimously to forward a recommendation of approval of the request to the County Board, and the Board action is the resolution.
All right. It's a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to PC 1315, please come up to the podium and state your name and address. Again, anyone wishing to speak to PC 1315, please come up to the podium and state your name and address. The last time, anyone wishing to speak to PC 1315, please come up to the podium and state your name and address. Seeing no one, what are the wishes of the board?
I'll move approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Go ahead.
Similar question, just the intent. What's the intent of them wanting to subdivide the land? You know,
I couldn't really see what their intent is. I'm assuming it's to sell off the two or one additional lot. They're on this property. There is one developed farmstead there already, and the applicant has started to develop the extreme eastern lot. Mm-hmm. And so there's one more lot to be built in the middle of this area.
Okay.
And my assumption is that he would be selling that off to whomever to develop that additional lot. So of the 3 lots that are proposed, one has been developed already. It's the current farmstead. And then there's 2 other lots, one of which the applicant is building his home on.
Okay.
And then an additional lot that would likely be up for sale. And then the 4 outlots, which are not buildable.
They're not buildable, right?
Correct.
And those are all tied, refresh my memory, would you, George, those are all tied to a certain number of acres in order to have buildable lots like this close to each other.
That's correct, and you recall that there is the allowance of 1 per quarter section, and so that did not come into play. They did not exceed that density, so there's no transfer development rights associated with this. And actually, it's a pretty wide area. A large landmass is being platted here, and the reason it is platted is because it's all one Torrens certificate, even though it was two parcels before. And so the extreme eastern lot, there is no change to the dimensions of that parcel line, but it was part of a Torrens certificate and therefore required to be part of this subdivision plat.
Okay. And then if they want to develop that lot 2, is that correct? Lot 2 is the one they want to develop possibly. Block 1. they would still have to come back to the county and go through planning and zoning and follow all the ordinances and things.
To obtain a construction permit, yes. Yeah, and actually, Commissioner, this is just the preliminary plat, yeah. So they will be coming forward with a final plat. Final
plan.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
I don't anticipate that changing at all, but it's just a formality.
I don't. It's hard to tell sometimes from the diagrams, you know, if it's going to be right on a bluff part of it, or it depends whether they want to build a home and that sort of thing, because it's in the shoreland, just a portion of the lot is. And so I didn't know if there's bluffs right there. It looks like there could be.
That ridge line that's on the western edge of that lot is a bluff.
It is.
It does meet the definition of a bluff, and so there would be the required setback to that.
Okay. Yeah. That light color on the one photograph, is that a field down below then, or what is that? Or is that an area that was mined out or something of sand or?
Yeah, that may be a question for the applicant. If I remember right, that may be an area of farm field, but I couldn't say for sure.
That lighter color?
Yes, yeah, I see what you're talking about. Kind of long rectangular shape, yes.
Okay. I don't know if anybody, there's nobody here. Is there from anybody here from that applicant's here?
The applicant is here.
Oh. What is that piece of land? Just curious, is that for farming down below that bluff or?
Down below the bluff, yes, it is. Yes, my name is Mitch Abbas.
Oh, hi.
Owner of that, and you're talking to the left, so you see a light colored strip.
Yeah,
that's an alfalfa field.
Oh, it is.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
It's just that I'm exploiting whatever
yep.
little patches of alfalfa I can harvest down the creek bottom.
That's nice, it. Good soil.
Good idea.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions?
Nope.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Against? That's been passed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, gentlemen. You. Nice yep. meeting you this
yep.
morning.
Thanks
Thank you.
Me pin.
And it looks like we can get right into Public Works.
Wow.
We should have set Aaron back up.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Al.
Morning, Al.
Nice, huh?
Morning, Al.
Hey, Al. Just a couple quick items, and I appreciate getting a couple of minutes during my off board normal schedule. We're acquiring, getting ready to construct 3 bridge deck replacements on County 5 from the county line south, basically, to Vetter's Quarry. So they're just new decks, but nonetheless, to use the new decks, we need a little more land to put shoulders on the road and to flatten the inslopes on the ditches, so they're narrow strips of land. We met with the 3 owners. They are supportive and understanding of the project. This would provide the authority to acquire that right away.
Can I just ask a question of you? I was just curious. I know this has come up in the past. That a lot of people, if it's the type of river that they use for any kind of canoeing or kayaking or anything like that, do we sometimes put a little trail going down to the river on our land then if we acquire
these,
that?
These streams are too small.
They're too small.
None of them are DNR public water.
They're not,
too small
okay.
for canoeing. Yep.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask us.
Except during the occasional flood, perhaps.
Yeah, sure.
And then just about any creek can be used.
Yeah, that's right.
And ditch.
Yeah, it's a little dangerous.
In some streets.
In some streets.
In my backyard, actually.
Oh, wow. I'll move approval of the resolution.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any questions or concerns? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Against? It's been passed.
And the other is the Mealy Munson flood hazard. A relocation project. As you know, we got a federal grant to pay for, I believe it was 80% of the cost. Mealy Munson would pay for the balance of the cost. Since we've started the project, initially the state had no money available to match federal money. The last legislative session, they set some money aside for that program. This resolution would allow us to apply for that money. So that would relieve the Mealy's and Munson's of much of their cost to match the federal money.
Also, it wouldn't up to the 25% that they could relieve them of that?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Well, that's pretty good.
Yeah, of the total If the state approved the grant, total estimated project cost is $475,000. This would request $118,750 from the DNR grant. You'd have $356,250 from the federal grant, and that would essentially take care of the project.
Amazing.
Mm-hmm. Federal and state.
Great. I'll move the resolution.
Okay, second it.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Against? It's been passed. Thank you.
Okay, it's been a fairly complex project to get through the works. The house and both houses are gone now.
They're gone now, though, yeah.
Yep. And they're just landscaping, filling the basements. Mm. I was out there on Friday, and if you go to the Neely's, for instance, you can see where the hole was, and the bluff is like 3 feet.
Yeah, it was very close for several years. It was real close.
Say, Al, I got one question for you.
Yes, sir.
I've had a lot of business owners and people that have commented on the landscaping for the roundabouts that are on Madison and 22 and Bell. Bell. Anyway, the landscaping, I mean, I think there's some black-eyed citizens there, but it's surrounded with thistles. In fact, it's surprising, knowing the city of Mankato's weed ordinance, that the city of Mankato hasn't done something about it, but it looks terrible. And since we are part of the, especially Madison and 22, could you please contact the DOT and find out what they can do for landscape? They did an amazing job on 12 and 14. I would expect only the same right in town.
Yeah, and that was an issue when we were negotiating the agreement with MnDOT. The city and county did not want to maintain those islands because of the traffic aspects. So I will check on that.
Yeah, it's an eyesore. It's an eyesore, and a lot of the businesses surrounding you. In fact, I was spoke to by the managers of Panera, and I know the manager from Red Lobster has been complaining about it, and I think the same one, so the business owners surrounding there are, it's an eyesore, and it looks bad. It's, plus noxious weeds.
If you look at the roundabout islands, Victory and Stadium is landscaped quite nicely. The city has been maintaining that island as part of our cooperative agreement and doing a good job with it. The two on 14 are county's responsibility to maintain, and we've been doing it via a lawn care kind of surface. It's not efficient for us to have our equipment operators out there pulling weeds when you can hire another company at a much lower rate to pull the weeds. They look very nice. The ones that we've constructed along 17 are low maintenance grass type, but they're not pretty, but they're grass, and we mow them with our highway mowers, and the weeds have not been a big problem there. The two on 22, I believe, are the state's responsibility, but I will check on that. So as we build these roundabouts, the question always comes up, how heavily should they be landscaped, and what about the future maintenance costs? We've been hesitant to get too much into heavily landscaped because of the maintenance costs, the labor required.
Well, even if, there's ways to landscape that doesn't have much of a maintenance cost.
Right.
But it doesn't, to keep the weeds out is kind of the
main. I think they're meant to be native prairie vegetation.
Yeah.
Which looks like weeds, especially
well,
in the
early stages. This is not native prairie.
It's a different kind.
And the thing is you got to be considerate of the businesses and the people surrounding there and stuff. So, okay, thank you.
I have a quick question. Sorry, real quick. I noticed too, I've been driving on state highways and some county highways. This time of year, it depends on what's growing next to the shoulder. What it looks like. Mm-hmm. Some people mow it, they have agreements with people to mow it and utilize the grasses and things, but some areas don't at all. And there's bushes, that are 5 feet high, 1 foot in from the shoulder, in areas where there's ditches and things, there's not trees right there or anything. And it just seems to me that I'm not accusing you or our department or anything, but the state and the counties, has it changed that much? Because it's a safety issue, I think, with all the deer and all the other wildlife that we have, especially for people who ride motorcycles and vehicles. You can't see wildlife anymore when they're approaching the road because it's so tall.
That's pretty heavily regulated, of course, like everything else we do. There's a law saying that you can't mow ditches except for basically July, except for shoulder cuts and sight distance corners.
Wow.
So our policy is we try to keep the shoulders mowed, keep sight distance mowed. We mow for noxious weeds, spray for noxious weeds. Every third year, we try to mow during that 1 month when we can mow the entire right-of-way out to control brush, thistles, and so on.
That's August? Is that August or end of July?
I believe it's July.
Mm-hmm. So it's then, because of the nesting birds and things like
that.
Yeah,
and that gets complicated by, do we have an easement there and the farmer owns the land, or does the county actually own the land?
Yeah.
Whether that law applies. So it is a complicated thing. But what's driven it now, of course, is with the rain we've had, it grows so fast.
Really big.
Having enough equipment and operators to mow it. Everything we have is ours. Or in the shop getting fixed.
Oh my goodness. I just thought maybe they would, I don't know how you would formally approach it, but if they could have like a minimum of 4 feet from the shoulder mowed.
Yeah.
Yep. Just mow that because you can't see when there's a.
And we're trying. We got everything out to make the shoulder cuts and mow that back.
Okay.
Thanks. Al, on
I'll attest to that. There were three mowers headed east out of Vernon Center this morning.
Yeah,
good.
They're high maintenance, those mowers, because they hit all the stuff in the ditches.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
On a better note, on 26 at 3rd Avenue and Industrial Road, which is started County 26, that's been a nice repair job.
Okay, good. So, good, thank you.
I'm on that a lot. So.
All right. Thank you.
Good comments from the residents along 32 also. That's a very nice road.
Good, thank you.
And I've been getting phone calls from a family or a gentleman and his wife down. It's south of Highway 60, along close to the county line, south of Medelia down that way.
Yeah.
And they're just so happy that they live in Blue Earth County, saying that the plow operators do such a wonderful job down there in the wintertime and grade the roads and take care of them so well. They live on a township road, I think, or not a township, but a county road next to it, right off of a township road. And I've gotten 3-4 phone calls from them over the last year.
Good.
Thanking Blue Earth County for the road maintenance down there too.
I'll pass that on to our maintenance folks.
Okay, way down there, kind of in the corner.
Sure.
Well, thank you, Al. I think we're going to take a break.
Thanks, Al.
Thanks, Al.
I am now.
I missed the hammer.
Yeah, we need the hammer. You know, we have to get her going again. But
you're scaring me with that.
Yeah.
Human
Let's use
services.
That
Phil,
aggressively.
It's your show.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Commissioners. I do have a number of action items that I need to bring to your attention for approval. The first of those is under public health, Minnesota Department of Health contract eliminating health disparities. There's really two components of this contract: refugee health needs through coordinated health assessment and treatment with the refugee population, and also coordination with MDH for treatment for residents identified as having latent or active tuberculosis infections. The amount of the grant, as you see, is pretty small, $3,300, which is actually a sizable increase from last round. So we need to augment these funds with our local Public Health Act funds in order to serve the community as we need to. Especially with regard to tuberculosis, there's been year-over-year increases in both the latent and active cases, and they take actually quite a bit of time to make sure that we contain those. So public health actually does do a lot of work in that area. Term of this contract, July 1st of 15 through June 30th of 16. Second item under public health is Minnesota Department of Health Public Health Emergency Preparedness. This is all hazards and pandemic emergencies, emergency response to include tornadoes, influenza, drought, ice storms, and the like. The best part of this is the building of partnerships that we've been able to do in the community with other emergency response and healthcare partners. The amount of this contract is $58,585, which represents a 50% increase. The term of the contract, July 1st of 15 through June 30th of 16.
That's a good question.
Yeah.
On that particular grant, Do we get to keep some of those funds? Are we required to spend them all? for a rainy day for events that do occur? I mean, do they allow any of that?
No. I mean, most of this is zero-based budgeting, Commissioner, and in public health in particular, there's very prescriptive budgets in each area. So there's a lot more detail that goes into each of these. Usually when you see an increase like we see there, we've been able to demonstrate that we have more need than we've been able to provide. And so because of that, you're eligible for more funds the next year. So they really do zero it out and roll it forward each year is how it's structured.
Wow. And yeah. So a lot of this is really paying for portions of people's salaries.
Absolutely.
They work on our plan, and they probably meet with the state. They meet with our deputies.
Absolutely,
and other people in the community.
Yep, and they do the tabletop exercises and practice. If this happens, then what happens?
Right,
and
right.
So those are all the coordinated efforts. You said it exactly right, that you have to actually cost out the staff per hour into these grants.
Yeah.
And so different staff will cover different areas and be parts all over the place in public health, more than any other place, even in human services.
Okay.
Thank you. Mental Health Center, we have one contract. Very pleased to announce that we have Deb Sowers, who is a doctor in nursing. She's an advanced practice nursing person who has her doctorate in nursing, to provide psychiatric medication management, urgent care diagnostic assessments to both Blue Earth County residents and our 10-county South Central community-based initiative. The contract is a fully encompassed rate at $100 per hour. There's no benefits. Capped at $166,400 per year. The rate is standardized based on a provider pay scale that we established. And the term of this contract is September 1st of 15 through August 31st of 16. Second to final section is supportive housing, one item there. And Minnesota Valley Action Council last month, I brought a number of different contracts that passed from the state to ourselves, Hearth Connections, and this is the final contract with MVAC for Family Homeless Prevention Assistance Program. This is the two different kinds of housing we do, this is the one that is more accessible to people who are either at risk of losing their house or just to stabilize their housing if they're even on the precipice of that. It's a nine county grant, big grant at $597,850. MVAC is the administrator and subcontracts with us for these services for what we call FHPAP. The term is July 1st of 15 through June 30th of 17, and this is a renewal grant. Disability services, one item, but actually five providers. We've formatted these contracts in this way in the past: Semi-Independent Living Services, Smiles, REM Heartland, Habilitative Services, Harry Myring Center, and Prairie Community Services all provide what we call SILS programming. Helps consumers remain in their homes through providing independent living skills. All five agencies are similar in their services, and we have had a history of offering this consumer choice through the different providers in town. The rates in all the providers will remain the same, and as you remember, there was some legislative action that changed the COLAs in some of these contracts in the past. The term for this contract, July 1st of 15 through June 30th of 16. And those are the action items I have for you today.
All right.
What are the wishes of the board?
I'll move the action items.
Second. Got a motion, second. Any discussion?
Just a little bit. Just looking at that first one you had, you know, it includes some services. Probably looks like the focus is on community health with the tuberculosis.
Right.
Issue. Is that really what I was getting at mostly? Or?
It really turns out to be that, Commissioner. I think there's some other diseases that could crop up that might take a lot of our attention, but at this time, in the past several years, tuberculosis has been the biggest part of that whole effort, definitely.
Okay, and I know that with that illness, usually a pill is prescribed for 365 days.
Right, exactly.
Isn't that how it goes?
Yes, I think it's called INH or something like that.
Yeah, and you have to
take it daily.
You don't get compliance.
Right, right. Then you're still active, and so when we all get our little mantos and you get the bump on your skin, you'd be active forever more, but they try to make sure that that's a latent TB and that it can't actually go active. if we have active TB, which we've had some concerns about this,
very serious,
and you actually have to do the full quarantine, you have to do an investigation of who that person has come in contact with, so it becomes
I've been
very,
a part of those before.
Have you really?
So that's why I know.
It's a lot of work, and it's serious.
It's a serious thing. You don't even know a loved one could have it or something.
Absolutely.
Well, and since it was one of those things that wasn't pretty much gone in our, at least in the United States, is it from influx of people from other places? Obviously, it's not contained yet.
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely about overseas travel. And certainly with the colleges where we have either people traveling overseas for their education or that they actually are from other parts of the world that come to MSU, that's one of the sources that we have to really monitor and make sure, as well as the refugee population.
It's a real insidious illness because even people who have worked in nursing homes and been exposed to it somehow, their body might not, they never became ill.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, so you're not infectious unless you're starting to cough and have night sweats and that sort of thing. And then what happens is you get older, let's just say you're 80 years old,
right,
and becoming more frail.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, it rears its ugly head.
Yes.
Settles into your lungs. Mm-hmm. You become extremely infectious. They have to put you in a negative airflow situation for a long time.
Wow.
And it basically kills you when you're that age.
Very serious.
Yeah. Well,
it used to be more common here and years ago.
Right.
I know it's the famous Doc Holliday, you know.
Yeah.
That was TB.
Very common. Yeah. A lot of our institutions in the state of Minnesota were TB. What did they call them? There's a
sanitarium.
Oh, sanitarium.
Yeah, and those were tuberculosis sanitariums.
Sure.
The one with Agua Ching, way up north, and it's gone now. That was a TB.
Yes, I remember that.
So that's what, like Marion Hall up at the Good Council.
Yes.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. Interesting. That's very interesting.
Yep.
Anyway,
all right.
Interesting stuff.
Mm-hmm.
All right. No more discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Against? Those are passed. You have some informational and discussion items?
I do, Mr. Chair. There's really just one item that I wanted to bring to your attention, and obviously I'm aware that the board can read and review this document. Through MACSA, the Minnesota Association of County Social Service Administrators, which we belong to and been very active in, and the policy committee, part of that, which is an affiliate of AMC, we developed this case management position paper, really, and I think the only real comment I have, and if there's any further discussion or questions from the board, I certainly would be willing to talk about this as much as we'd want to, but just to make you aware that I think our concern is that we've had a standard of practice over the years in case management in a lot of disciplines. So this paper I've given you is an umbrella paper, and what we're going to do is add one-page descriptors in each discipline. So like for disability services or for supportive housing, we're going to have a descriptor, and I certainly will share those with the board once they're published, and really to attach to this umbrella paper. But what we did want to do is provide a definition from a county perspective of what case management really is. Bob and I have talked about this some, and I think it will be an ongoing dialogue that I want the board to be aware of with regard to some pressures that are out there. The past practice has been, it's pretty much been a county operation. We do case management in a lot of different areas, and it is our bread and butter, it is our core that attaches, even the psychiatric stuff that we do, the core of that is really case management, and then those individuals need primary health or psychiatric services or whatever that attaches to the hub of that wheel. This paper really tries to just make the case that there's an advantage for counties to be linked because we can walk down the hall or down one floor and hook up with public health as well as social services as well as financial services. The pressure that is out there is a couple of the biggest metros, I believe it's Ramsey and Hennepin, have contracted out their case management to a vendor. Now that's a hybrid option that we're very supportive of and is talked about in the paper. That really says, and something that Bob and I have talked about, that really says that we can use other vendors to do this work, but we still want to play an overseer role and make sure that linkage still happens. And then the third option, which I really do want to make the board aware of, is privatization, full privatization, where I think you would really see a fragmentation of case management, where vendors could get into the business of case management, but do it in isolation, do it just for supportive housing, or just for the disability, or just for even child protection and things. And I think that fragmentation would not be good for our consumers in that we would lose all of that integration, all of that ability to talk to one another. So there's kind of three different options. We're obviously in the core service option, which I strongly support. There is some issue, as you well know, in the decisions you've had to make about our staffing and the fact that we're a hub community, that there is a hybrid model out there that's also got some experience in the large counties in the metro. And then there is this pressure to privatize. And I just wanted to make sure that this dialogue kind of is out there for all of us so that we know that those pressures are out there, that there are vendors who are very much interested in being in the business, but I would say within a silo. And I would prefer for our consumers that that's not how we do our business, but that we really do integrated care. So that's why I wanted to get you the paper. I will share with you through some venue, maybe through the board or a work session, some of those additional papers that will be published, just the one-page descriptions of the different case management. So that's why I wanted to include it in the report, Mr. Chair.
All right. Thank you very much.
Appreciate that.
I ask make a comment too, just long. What you're saying about that, I was thinking about you out at the NACO annual conference, and there was a lot of people in your position that were there.
Right.
And some of the options like you're bringing up here, I appreciate, because there's people in our areas of our country who have seen, especially in larger counties, cities, the advantages of having actually merged some of their departments.
Right.
Maybe not totally, but.
Right.
And what they, one of the models is merging your health and behavioral health with probation and jails.
Oh, sure.
They've actually put that all together.
Interesting.
And they've reduced the number of people in jails by up to 40% in those areas over a short period of time.
Right.
Saving millions of dollars.
You bet. Absolutely.
And they find that the case management, having much better outcomes when they can help a lot of these people who are not criminals.
Right.
They've even gone to the point where they have a county-state relationship where the states have changed some of the felonies to gross misdemeanors to easily handle them in the courts and in the legal system. And so it's a thing that's really happening. I wish you were there because you would better understand it.
Sure.
Than I did.
Yep.
Absolutely. You know, because I don't work directly in that area.
Right.
And I was sitting there thinking, I wish Phil was here. just to hear about
how
they're doing it.
Absolutely, yes. Definitely.
And there are some links I can probably try to find to send you. But
absolutely. If you can, Commissioner, I'd appreciate that. And I'm certainly interested in that. And that is the continuum of what we're talking about. As you know, we're obviously combined public health and social services, and that isn't that common still even in Minnesota. I think the work that we've done with the Sheriff's Department to try to combine some of those things and integrate care, and it's right along the lines of what you're saying, if we can do it in corrections and all of that as well. Yeah. And as you're fully aware that other places in Minnesota, they've combined some counties in health and human services, and I think there's kind of a mixed report at this point. It's early with some of the newer ones. Obviously Faribault Martin has been together for a long time and that's stabilized, but the economy of scale and how you can throw your resource at that and maximize efficiencies, that's definitely what we're after. So.
Well, what's interesting in the state of Minnesota, prison count per population is much lower than the average prison count across the United States. Yeah. You go to Wisconsin, their prison count is double per population than the state of Minnesota's, and that has a lot to do with how we do our probation, how we do our prosecution and stuff like that. And we don't, crime-wise, we don't have more crime than less crime than Wisconsin, but we do have less people in our prisons.
And that has to do with the case management.
It has a lot to do with case management and how we operate our probation, and that makes a huge difference.
It does. One county reported a 50% reduction, or 51 days reduction average on people in jail.
Wow.
Just through this sort of a shared case management with
health, community health, and behavioral health, and the probation people
right.
working together to find services for people so that then when they leave jail, they're not just turned out to a cold society necessarily. They know they've got some kind of services available to them to help them.
Yep.
Otherwise, they end up right back in jail.
Absolutely. So. But like you say, both the quality of that, to be able to have a good strategy about discharge, but also the just pure dollars of saving 50 jail days, I mean, that's a lot.
That's a lot.
So, yeah, per person is.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Phil.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Phil.
All right, Bob, we're going to get back into some administrative services.
Now, Mr. Chair and Commissioners, first up is the County Board minutes of July 7th.
Wishes of the board?
Move the minutes.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Amended minutes.
Well, there's a specific amendment.
Oh, I'm sorry, that's another one.
Specific one down at...
I was punching the wrong one.
Yeah, watch what you punch.
This is what happens when you get something fancy. Like
I know, you got this fancy...
operator error there.
All right, got a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? It passes. Bills?
Move the bills.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion?
I had a couple.
Go ahead.
Okay. Just curious on a few of them here. Annixter Brothers Incorporated with some equipment purchased for $34,158.
That is some items for the recabling of the government center, so part of our infrastructure improvements in our IT area.
Huh?
Mm.
Wow. I think I heard about that. There were some problems with the wiring or something, or there was some problem?
Well, it's just an upgrade. The wiring in that building hasn't been dealt with for 25 years, so our computer network needs some improved cables so that we can operate the network at its full efficiency.
In what building was it, did you say?
In the government
center. Government center. Oh, okay. Right. That makes sense, yeah. And then there's a right-of-way from Ferris Johnson Law, $257,000.
That is part of the CASA 12 Stage 5 development, so that final leg of County Road 12.
So is that quite a bit of that area then, that leg or not?
I don't know exactly the parcel involved,
really?
But we allocated 1.5 million, so
yeah,
it's
of our
not
general funds.
Right.
That's the first piece I think we bought.
Right.
The first part.
I think it's the first one for that price.
Must be a good size piece though, I mean, for that cost. $250,000. Fredrickson Healthcare Consulting was $5,132.
That is a billing audit that we're doing as a part of the South Central Community-Based Initiative. So basically looking at the billing services of the hub to make sure we're maximizing our third-party billings.
Interesting, okay. And then the RNG construction for $453,000.
That is a payment on the CASA 1 road project that's going on currently.
Okay, I thought that was a good chunk. There's in the second week, there's that Foth infrastructure, and it has three buildings all in a row. One's for buildings for $9,800, one's for construction services for $11,000-something, and one's for land improvements for $27,000. I was just curious what project. That must be one project, I would think.
Well, it's a combination of both the Cell 12 development at the landfill as well as work being done on the new building out
at
Ponderosa.
So it's all related?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And then there was the Stinson Leonard Street attorney fees for $4,000.
That one I will have to look up.
I was working hard there.
You were doing really well, too. I was proud of Bob. He was popping right off, and then all of a sudden you caught him.
Drew gets the prize today.
Drew gets the prize.
He's done yet. He's still digging.
Yeah,
but you have to buy a pie or something for me. out at the damn cafe.
You know what? I think the prize will be we will allow you to buy the pot.
Yeah.
Those are court-appointed attorney's fees, part of the public defender reimbursements.
Yeah, you got it.
There you go.
Wow. Tough. Well, then I'll just give you one more since he found that right away. Jones and Magnus Law.
Probably the same.
Attorney fees, very similar, $3,000 something. The reason I'm asking is that I just know we hire a lot of attorneys for things, and we've got attorney's office. I just like to know what kind of stuff they're doing, and it's just kind of good to know.
A lot of that child protection stuff can't be done inside
can't
of Pat's
office.
Can't
be done in-house, can it?
No.
Okay.
Because they're doing the prosecuting side of it.
Was that in week one?
Two.
Two.
It's in two, yeah. Jones yeah, and Magnus.
The one on Madison Avenue there.
Okay, yeah. It's a beautiful building, the way they remodeled that building. Did you notice that?
Yeah, from tools to lawyers,
yeah,
whatever.
Go that figure. Is the same as the previous one. It's the court-appointed attorney fees.
For public defending type things? Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
All right. Anyone else? No other discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? Passed. Human resources, Bob? All
right. Mr. Chair and Commissioners, we do have some action items this morning. All the items listed for action today are related to the recently enacted legislation regarding child protection. I'd like to review all the positions now and then ask the board for board action individually on each hire after I've shared some more background. We are requesting three new full-time equivalents in the Human Services Department to meet the legislative mandate included in Senate File 1428, which outlines new child protection screening and service expectations. Funding was allocated by the legislature to assist counties in meeting the screening and service requirements. Roughly $203,000 has been allocated to Blue Earth County based on the formula in the new statute. The formula provides a base level of funding for all counties and then allocates remaining dollars based on child populations and child protection needs. 20% of those funds will be withheld pending meeting certain performance measures. The three positions indicated here include two social workers. One social worker will be completing child protection investigations and assessments. The other will provide ongoing case management services to children and their families who have been determined to be in need of child protective services. The third new position is a case aide to provide assistance with reporting and data management. This position will also assist with our intake and support of the case management services provided to those families. The cost breakdown, basically each of the social workers with benefits will run about $75,000 each, and the case aide with benefits will be in the neighborhood of $55,000. The fourth authorization listed on the agenda is again related to child protection legislation, but comes out of the Sheriff's Department. This request will not add an additional FTE, but rather moves an existing patrol position up to an investigator level to deal with the additional investigative workload resulting from the legislation. This position adjustment is ineligible for the use of the new funding, as the legislature was very prescriptive in terms of where the money could be utilized. Child protection screenings must now be reviewed by law enforcement, which is driving this request. The additional cost for this change in the investigator role is roughly $7,000. And so with that, Mr. Chair, I'd be willing to answer any questions that you or the board have regarding these positions.
I have one question. So you said that we were required to do the last one with the Sheriff's Department and social services, basically, is child protection.
Right.
But we were required, mandated by the state to do this, but we were not given any extra funds to do this.
Well, the screenings now have to be reviewed by law enforcement. So as the Human Services Department works through their screening process, they also have to refer those cases to law enforcement for their review as well.
And I understand it's a very positive thing. I've talked to the folks in the Sheriff's Department and Human Services. It's a very positive note. The only issue I have is the state of Minnesota coming down and mandating a change and that and requiring counties to have to pay for that change. So it's an unfunded mandate. Whether it's good or bad, it is a mandate, another mandate dictated to us by the state of Minnesota.
Yeah, it's very fortunate that the legislature did recognize the human service cost increases that will come with this new legislation, but you're right, we do have some other costs throughout the legal system that is ineligible for use of that funding.
But all four positions are full-time, are they including the sheriff position there?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. All right. You want us to go through these one at a time?
Commissioner Campbell has a question.
I think for help, for clarification too, though, I think, I thought about this when I looked at them. I had just a nice little conversation with you too, but they're already doing some of this already. I mean, the sheriff's office is already, I mean, let's just say a third of the, fourth of the child protection cases or whatever were being reported to the sheriff's office anyway for some investigation or follow-up if they believed that there was something that needed to be.
Right. If there were potential criminal charges that could come, that would be true.
Yeah. So some of the cases get referred there anyway, and I don't know who up there normally, you know, particularly gets those. If it's the deputy, senior sheriff, or if it's the
investigator positions have
the investigator positions
done those reviews.
So now what'll happen? It looks like there'll just be one individual who will be the point person for all of those. Reports that come in through human services, or is it going to still be shared? Or
I believe it'll still be shared. It'll be spread based on volume. You know, there might be some targeted expertise, but again, depending on the volume of reports that come in, I believe all the investigators will ultimately have some involvement in these screening processes.
So that's what I'm just trying to figure. I just am confused still about a child protection vulnerable adult investigator, if they're just going to be the ones that, if they're all going to be doing it, but we're going to have a full-time person doing it.
Well, we already have some investigators, so this will be adding to the number of investigators that are available in the Sheriff's Department to handle that workload.
But it sounds like they're going to be using mostly child protection investigation, and they won't be doing other investigations. Is that true, or...?
I think they are trying to target some of the work to this volume, so there will be some expertise that will be developed by one of the investigators, but again, based on volume, they may have to pull in other investigators as well.
Okay. And then the other thing that goes through my mind is I know that there's a plan for possibly hiring 4 to 5 new deputies next year. So is an investigator considered a deputy sheriff in our system?
Yes.
They are still a deputy sheriff. Well, you would know. You did it for
me.
And so then this is not really an additional one, but it's taking one off the force, so to speak, isn't it?
That's correct.
So we'll be down a deputy sheriff.
Yeah, what the sheriff's office has indicated is basically the new position that was authorized for 2015. They just filled that position, but they would shift that responsibility, not necessarily for that officer, but for one of the patrol deputies, they would move it into an investigator role. Part of the reason we're bringing it forward to the board is the investigator is at a higher classification level.
Yeah.
And since we don't have authorization from the board to have another position at that level, we need that to bring that to the board here today.
And their title will be Child Protection Vulnerable Adult Investigator. I mean, that will be their primary title or
not? That's correct.
It will be?
Yes.
Okay. And then we'll still be, we created a gap, so we're going to add one more request then to our request that we might have for next year
for some changes?
That doesn't appear to be the plan. You know, so the 2016 budget request for the additional patrol deputies will be a separate discussion, but they have not indicated that they would increase that to 5 or whatever as a result of this.
So it was 4.
They're just doing some shifting within the department.
Okay. And then just since we're on that, just because it relates to this, is I was going to request to see what has been looked at as far as adjusting schedules and scheduling of the deputies to cover this plan that might be coming up for next year. I just want to mention I'd like to look at that sometime too, Bob, to see what has been looked at to try to cover certain shifts and do all these kind of things that we were talking about with the sheriff's office. If we're indeed going to approve, you know, 4 more positions for the deputy sheriff.
My plan is to have some of that discussion occur at our work session next week, so we certainly can get into that a little deeper at that.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
I'll move all the different do them all at one time.
We
have to do one at a separate one each time.
Separate.
So let's do A first.
I'll move A.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? A is passed. B.
Okay.
Got a motion?
Second.
And a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? Passed. C.
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? C is passed. And D.
I'll make motion for D for the child protection.
Second it.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? Passed. So, we'll get into the informational.
We have 3 individuals that were hired, one social worker, a 911 dispatcher, and a land use specialist, so continue our hiring practices. We have then 3 individuals that have completed their probationary period and are eligible for salary adjustment, and you'll see the folks listed there. Answer any questions if the board has any, otherwise I'd move on to the next item.
Okay, move on to the next.
Can I make one comment?
Sure can.
I was at the NACO, you know, conference, and I was in a room of 50 people, and quite a few counties represented in there. And we talked about supportive services for people with persistent mental health issues in their communities. And I asked people in the room to raise their hands if they had a clubhouse-type situation in their county or in their city. And I think 3 other hands went up. So we should be, it's a good deal that we've got something like this in our community. Mm-hmm. That means a lot of communities don't have anything like this to give support to those with persistent mental illness. And it involves them in the community, they become volunteers, they train, they go on trips, they do all kinds of things. It's just a place to go too if they want some place to go during the day, if they need a little support. And so I just wanted to say it's a wonderful thing that our county has this mental health clubhouse right while it's right across the street over here. And I just assumed most communities had them, and they don't.
So all right.
It's been here a long time, too. How many years, Bob? 20?
Oh, more than 20.
25?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's a wonderful thing.
Okay. Go ahead, Bob.
Mr. Chair and Commissioners, item number 4 in your packet then is a request for a resolution authorizing the Environmental Services Department to update the Blue Earth County Comprehensive Water Management Plan. This is a plan that ultimately is approved by the Minnesota Board of Water and Soil Resources because they oversee the overall preparation of the plan and ultimately approve it before it comes back to the county board for adoption. What we're doing here today is basically passing a resolution to start the planning process. assuming the board approves the resolution, an official notice of intent to update the plan and an invitation to participate in the planning process will be sent to all local units of government in the county, adjacent counties, state review agencies, including the Minnesota Board of Water and Soil Resources, the DNR, the Department of Health, Department of Agriculture, and the PCA. And so with that, Mr. Chair, I'd request approval of the resolution to update the Blue Earth County Water Management Plan.
I'll so move that.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Just that, and this is required, I think, isn't it, too, Bob? I mean, this is something we have to do.
This is a statutory requirement. It will be a 10-year plan, and this is the fourth time that we have completed that 10-year cycle.
Julie works hard on it.
Yep. All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? It's been passed. And our Homeland Security Emergency Management Joint Powers Agreement.
Item number five in your packet is that Joint Powers Agreement. This is a Joint Powers Agreement that looks at emergency management services, both from a training perspective as well as a response in a situation of emergency. And so we're recommending approval of this Joint Powers Agreement and assigning Mike Maurer, the Chief Deputy, and our current Emergency Manager as our representative to this Joint Powers.
Wishes of the Board?
So move.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? It's passed.
Item number six in your packet is a renewal of an agreement with Advanced Correctional Healthcare, which provides inmate health services and nursing services in our jail. The jail administrator has negotiated a 1.75% increase in the service cost, which is based on the consumer price index. The total amount of this contract then is estimated to be just over $196,000 and is effective August 1st of this year. So I recommend approval of that contract.
All right. Wishes of the board?
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Go ahead.
Part of the workshops I attended also talked a lot about this, these issues, the expenses of providing care, and I told a lot of them how we're handling this the last few years by having people not having to transport so much, you know, for getting care in our jail, and that's fairly common amongst a lot of the jails. But the one thing they did bring up again, which I'll mention, is the Medicaid issue, that many of the people who end up in jail are of poverty level, and they meet the requirements for being obtaining assistance of Medicaid and the programs that are related to Medicaid. And so they're actually, there's an effort to get people signed up for Medicaid when they enter the system, before they go through the court itself, and that way, and that relates to the one thing you brought up,
exactly,
to not discontinue their Medicaid, but to postpone it, or whatever they do, what was the term,
suspend it rather than cancel it,
then terminate. Yeah. So, and they found, some communities have found this is really helping a lot, because it gets them into case management, gets them care, because they get out of jail, and so then it shortens those jail days in the future. Please.
There was a push in Minnesota a year or two ago on that very issue, and so there have been connections made between the Sheriff's Department and the Human Service Department to try and ensure that people that are eligible for medical assistance can receive that health care coverage. So that is a topic that's been very concerning to counties and actively pursued, trying to get the State Department to change some policies which allowed for that coverage to continue in certain cases where people are incarcerated before they're convicted and those sorts of things. So
yeah,
that's an area that has been received some focus in county circles in the last few years.
Okay. All right. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Against? That's passed.
Mr. Chair and Commissioners, item number 7 in your packet then is an amendment to the April 14th board minutes. We found through some work that the finance department does to verify contracts that a contract that was approved at that meeting was not recorded in the minutes, and so we're going back to make this correction and provided you amended minutes for that particular board meeting. And I'm recommending approval of those amended minutes.
Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Do you guys know what you're doing or what?
Yeah.
All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Passed.
Mr. Chair, item number 8 in your packet are the donations received for the second quarter of this year. You'll notice again that the library continues to receive some generous gifts from individuals and other parties in the community. The other item I would draw your attention to is the parks towards the bottom of the first page, where the Mankato Foundation has provided a grant of $13,194, which has been used for the signage out at the Williams Nature Center.
Oh, all right.
Very, nice. Very good.
The second page, yeah. Then? Oh, I'm sorry, Mr.
Oh, no. It had to do, I was going down to the window. There are a lot of, I see a lot of state properties and parks that, yeah, signs are in bad shape as, yeah, it's ours. Right. Was ours, the one, Williams. Yep.
Out on the prairie there, isn't it?
Yeah. Thank you.
The second page then are the in-kind donations, and so at this point, Mr. Chair, I'd request acceptance of the donations for the second quarter.
Sure. Wishes of the board?
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Against? It's passed.
Item number 9, your packet then, is the financial status report for June 30th, so this is halfway through our fiscal year. You'll see that the total revenues are at 43% of the total, where our total expenditures are at 39%. The expenditures are lagging behind largely because of the slow construction season. It's been wet, and so there hasn't been as much work on some of the road projects as would typically be the case at this time of the year. That is picking up now, of course, so we should see our expenditures come a little closer in line with the budget. The personnel services you'll see is at 45.4%, so that's not surprising given the number of staff that we have, that those expenditures would be flowing. Some of the turnover is why then we're not at the 50% level. Those are some savings that we often see throughout the year. Back up on the revenue side, you'll see the state and federal dollars are at 37% of our budget. That also is not uncommon at this time of the year, where some of our state revenue is issued annually in July. So we will see some change with the next month's report that should pull that a little closer into line.
Okay.
The second page then shows the fund balances, and you'll see again that we continue to be sitting in a solid position, both in terms of our total available funds as well as our total fund balance overall. So with that, Mr. Chair or Commissioners, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer those.
Sounds very good.
Looks good.
Mm-hmm. And that should be it for the day.
That's all we have for today, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Motion to
recess. Motion to recess to the Rapidan Dam store for a luncheon
Dam
meeting.
Store restaurant, yes.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right.